Good evening, everybody. I'm Peter Steeves. It's my privilege to be the director of the DePaul Humanities Center. Apart from being the center's director, I'm also a professor of philosophy, and it's the literal meaning of the word philosophy that brings us together this evening. Philosophistry means love of wisdom. It's the passion that makes the modern university what it is, the passion that brought every professor at DePaul to his or her subject area, including the ones you're about to meet. And there's an important lesson to learn, I believe, from the very first great professor of the West, Socrates. Socrates was born sometime around 470 BCE in Athens, Greece, but it's his death that calls our solemn attention this evening. His death, we know with certainty, took place in the year 399 BCE. We're sure of this because we have clear and multiple records of Socrates' death. And this is due to the fact that Socrates was executed by the Athens government after having been tried and found guilty of crimes against the state. There were two crimes, in fact, impiety and corrupting the local youth. For this, he was made to drink the hemlock and die. The impiety accusation amounted to some powerful people being upset about Socrates' supposed refusal to worship the same gods that the city worshipped. These were trumped-up charges. More interesting was the charge of corrupting the youth. Supposedly, Socrates, the professor, had been trying to convince his students to question authority. And there's nothing more dangerous than an authority figure who encourages those who would learn from him or her to question everything, even what he or she is teaching. There were families and friendships and passions in ancient Athens, but Socrates asked his students to think about what love really was. There was art in ancient Athens, but Socrates asked his students to think about what beauty really was. There were laws in ancient Athens, but Socrates asked his students to think about what justice really was. This is the kind of teaching that gets you in trouble. And so it was that Socrates was put on trial, facing a jury comprised of 500 of his fellow citizens chosen by lottery to serve at the legal proceedings that would decide whether or not he would be punished and eventually executed. Plato, Socrates' most famous student, wrote an account of his teacher's defense entitled The Apology. Here we have the speech that Socrates made at his trial, a speech that promised it would not use rhetorical skills and beautiful words to mask the truth and trick the members of the jury, but in the end, it was full of both truth and beauty. The Apology is one of the most important works by Plato because in it we see not only an argument being made for why philosophy and love of wisdom in general are important, but we see Socrates actually doing philosophy in defense of philosophy, showing as well as saying exactly what it is that he's standing up for and ultimately will die for. These are words that continue to bolster the work we do at the university today as scholars, teachers, and as students. They're words that continue some 2.5 millennia later to inspire what our university is about at its core. They are words that deserve our serious attention before we get underway this evening. And so, for just a moment, I ask you to imagine yourself as one of the 500 jury members as I recount for you in very brief summary what Socrates had to say at his defense. Imagine you're back in Athens, squinting in the afternoon haze, the sun reflecting off the Mediterranean Sea behind us, a warm breeze in your face, the faint scent of olives and figs in the air. You're gathered here in your seats, justice waiting to be done, a man's life hanging in the balance. I am no Plato, but when I imagine Socrates standing up to begin his defense, I picture the old, wise, stub-nosed man rising slowly, his eyes staring unblinkingly into every set of eyes of his accusers, but with compassion rather than anger. The moment still and quiet, the very fate of knowledge and learning and teaching about to be decided. I imagine Socrates fully aware of his place in history, and I imagine him offering his defense in words that went something like this. Fellow citizens, gathered before me today. Look at this studio filled with glamorous prizes, fabulous and exciting merchandise, totaling more than $500, all of which could be yours, or yours, or yours! Live from Lincoln Park, Chicago, the entertainment and Vincentian mission capital of the world, it's the DePaulywood Squares! Tonight, 10 lucky contestants from our studio audience in reality are almost kind of great in a Barnes & Noble sort of way, all with the help of nine of DePaul's most tic-tac-toe-ous celebrity professors. So, put your hands together and join me in welcoming first, from the Department of Sociology, DePaul's most awesomely inked up wild American dog professor, Greg Scott! It's Department of English that Ann Bartlett is from. Coming to you from the Department of Philosophy, but let's face it, most likely by hours spent at the local option, it's our center square, DePaul's very own Paul Lynn, Professor Rick Steeves. Will Archmedium Design be sending us hip-hop megastar Beverly Fresh? A pancake-eating, record-breaking Mr. Midwest? Will it be our very own Professor Zach Ostrowski? Next up, he once shot another associate dean in the LASM's dean's office just to watch him die, and also to end early a bylaws reconciliation committee meeting revising government documents to ensure that said house documents were in sync with the university faculty handbook's latest and subsequent iteration. Show some respect for Professor of History Warren Schultz! Here to tell you that you have all been accepted to the theater school's prestigious conservatory program. You'll be cared for, respected, and nurtured from here on out, and by the end of the evening, 99% of you will be ruthlessly cut from the room. It's the theater school's own Professor Lisa Bartman! Why Pluto got demoted as a planet, and what's wrong with Uranus. From the Department of Physics, give it up for Professor Jesus Bando! These are your celebrity professors. And now, to truly get things started, your host for the evening. He began in Chicago, moved to Austin, Texas, but is back with us tonight because most of those local warrants have expired. Please join me in welcoming the very sparkly Pete Parsons!
Tonight, DePaul, hello. Oh my, you all look fantastic. All right, what do you say, guys? You like my jacket? I thought I'd go something a little less flashy tonight. Yes, welcome to DePaulywood Squares, the game show where contestants agree or disagree with answers provided by the DePaul faculty here. Now, who here's ever played tic-tac-toe before? Fantastic. All right, that's great. Love to see it. All right. Now, for those of you who are transfer students, I'll tell you how tic-tac-toe works, all right? Okay. We're going to be asking questions to the professors. These students will then get to agree or disagree. The respective signs, too, they will get that symbol on the board. Sounds complicated. It's not really, folks. We'll be great. All right. Peter, are we ready to start the show? Do we have some lovely contestants?
I think we are ready, Pete. Are you ready to start, everybody?
Yeah! All right. Sounds great. Let's start the tic-tac-toe. Let's get them in line, Peter.
Come on down, Shelby Robinson. You're the first to hit.
Fantastic. Oh, why don't we just talk to that microphone right there? That's what it's for. Shelby, would you mind sharing with us your major?
My major is interactive and social media.
Ooh, interactive and social media. Excellent. Would you mind explaining a little bit of that?
It's pretty much like web design, basically.
All right, I didn't know I asked for attitude. And fantastic. Angela, hello, welcome. Awesome. Are you a fellow DePaul student as well?
I am.
Fantastic. Well, what's your major?
Public Relations and Advertising.
Public Relations and Advertising. Great. What's the favorite thing about the public that you have?
There's not one.
Oh, good thing you chose that major. All right. Fantastic. All right. So as this always goes, the X will start first. So, Shelby, pick your professor right there. Just say their name, and I will ask them the question.
Zach.
Okay. All right. First question is for Zach Ostrowski. All right. All right, Zach, how you doing?
Real good.
Always love our talks. All right, Zach, your first question, okay? All right, here we go. Alan Abel, perhaps America's most preeminent prankster and hoaxer, created one of the most famous incidents ever to take place on a daytime talk show back in 1985. What did Abel organize as part of an airing of the Phil Donahue Show?
Alan Abel, he's a good friend of mine. And, he put some pants on my golden retriever, and things are a lot better now. But I think the event that you're talking about isn't Cinna. It is the Donahue fainting incident.
Okay, all right, Shelby, it's the Donahue fainting issue. Do you agree or disagree with that answer?
Agree.
She's gonna agree, and you are correct. X gets the square. What square would you like, huh?
Professor Greg Scott.
Professor Greg Scott said with extreme enthusiasm. All right. Okay. All right. Greg, your question. All right.
Bring it.
Often called the father of gonzo journalism, this Kentucky native first became famous for living with and then writing about the Hell's Angels. Who is this Las Vegas-loving writer?
Well, it's interesting that you would ask the question about what would seem to be Hunter S. Thompson, but it's actually not. It's not widely known that that book, Hell's Angels, which was his first major publication in terms of a book-length manuscript, was actually ghostwritten by Bill Monroe. Bill Monroe from Kentucky.
Bill Monroe from Kentucky. What do you say, Angela? Do you agree or disagree? Oh, she's gonna agree. I am so sorry. That is not correct answer. X gets the square. Right? See, folks, you're just saying yes or no. It's a lot how you guys take your finals, okay? Okay, Shelby, you're up again. What square would you like?
Professor Lisa Portes.
Professor Lisa Portes. All right, excellent. From the theater school. Excellent. Lisa, how you doing?
I'm great.
Fantastic. Such a great stage presence right there. Hard to believe she's a director, huh? Great. From which Shakespearean play is the following quote taken? Oh, that this too sullied flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself into a dew, or that the everlasting had not fixed his canon against self-slaughter?
Beautifully performed. You know, there's a great movie called With Noll and I. Mm-hmm. And if you know With Noll and I, again With Noll and I, there's a wonderful quote which says, "There comes a time in every man's life when he realizes he will never play the Dane." It's Hamlet.
Hamlet, all right, excellent. Shelby, what do you say? Do you agree or disagree?
I'm going to go ahead and agree.
Just going to go ahead and agree. You are correct. X gets the square. We support that. Excellent. Now, you had a fantastic rendition, too, of that directed at DePaul not too long ago, correct?
Well, I did direct it at DePaul. I'm glad you thought it was fantastic.
I did. I didn't get cast in it, but I thought it was great.
Yeah, as I said, never play the Dane.
Yeah, I'll also never play 30, so. Okay, Angela, you're up. Who would you like to take the square from?
Center Square, Rick Lee.
Center Square, Rick Lee. Oh, boy. Choice, kind of. All right. Socrates was an ancient Greek philosopher who was well known for saying that a certain kind of life is not worth living. What sort of life isn't worth living, according to Socrates?
It's probably a widely known fact that more than anyone else, I can't stand Socrates. I think Socrates is one of the worst philosophers in the entire history of philosophy, and I'm sick and tired of living under Socrates' death. He died for philosophy. Philosophy's not something I will ever die for. I think what he said was the unexamined life is not worth living.
The unexamined life is not worth living. What do you think about that?
I'm gonna agree.
You're gonna agree? You are correct. Circle Woo! Gets the square. Rick, Socrates, like, run over your dog or something?
I mean, I don't know how many ways to say sodomy, but it seems like that should be brought up.
Okay, all right. It's a family show. All right, here we go. All right, Shelby, you are up next. Which square would you like?
Professor Warren.
Professor Warren Schultz. Excellent, excellent. All right. Professor Warren Schultz. Excellent. All right, here you go. Writing in the 14th and 15th centuries of the Common Era, Islamic historian Al-Barqizi said the following: "It has no root among any community that believes in revealed religion, nor legal foundation for its implementation." What is the "it" that he was talking about?
I think the word is sodomy.
Crazy was a noted polemicist.
Everybody knows that.
And genuinely curmudgeonly fellow. And what he's referring to here is the practice of actually lending money at usury.
Ah, so you'd say money is
money lending. Yes.
All right, Shelby, would you agree or disagree?
I agree.
Oh, excellent. You're going to agree. You are correct. X gets the square one. What do you say? What tile do you want?
Professor Jesus.
Professor Jesus, all right, excellent. Jesus, hello, how you doing?
Okay.
Excellent, all right. Here's your question. At the start of the universe itself, this measure of disorder, usually abbreviated with the capital letter S, is said to be at its lowest point. What is the term for this measure of disorder? And it's not what Rick Lee thinks it is.
No, I know it's not. Rick does that in a very orderly fashion.
Hey-o! Hey-o! Out to Hollywood Squares and a roast is about to break out. Here we go.
I'm going to stop there and say entropy.
Entropy, all right.
I'm going to agree.
You're going to agree? You are going to get the square? Oh, gets the square. Fantastic. All right. This is a certainly interesting tactic of tic-tac-toe that we were playing. Shelby, you're up. Let's see what you got. What tile are you going to go for?
Professor Ann.
Professor Ann Bartlett. Fantastic. Now, I need to remind you folks, Shelby, if you do get this wrong, you do not only do not get the tile, it will go to Angela, but if you want to win the round, you do need to win this tile on your own. You can't win by default. If that makes sense. Fantastic. You'll get it, guys. Trust me. It's not that hard of a game. All right. All right. Professor Ann Bartlett, here we go. There are three qualities we patriarchically associate with medieval women, all of whom who were thought to be chaste, silent, and...
I'm not going to say the obvious.
I would hope not, because it wouldn't fit.
Why is it interesting? Okay, chaste, silent, it's C, S, Z, zithery.
Chaste, silent, and zithery. That's your answer? Fantastic. All right, Angela, would you agree or disagree?
It's not my question.
It's not your question, that's right. This is what happens when you pay attention, folks. Just check it. All right, excellent. Shelby, would you agree or disagree?
I'm going to disagree.
She's going to disagree.
No, I said agree.
You're going to agree. You're going to agree. I'm sorry, that is incorrect. O gets the square for that one. I'm so sorry. The correct answer is obedience. Obedience is the answer.
That word just doesn't pass my lips.
It doesn't either for my four-year-old. All right. Okay, Angela, you are up next. Let's see. Well, this is just going to be for fun. All right. So whoever has the most tiles will win this round. So we'll go with that. All right. All right, Angela, pick a tile. For God's sake.
Professor Susan.
Professor Susan, excellent, excellent. Professor Susan, hi, how are you? Good to see
Great.
You. Excellent. All right, here's your question. It's appeared in countless plays, stories, songs, and poems, but who originally coined the term star-crossed lovers?
Well, I thought you'd never ask. So, star-crossed lovers, not contrary to popular belief, was not coined by Shakespeare. It goes way back, and it was originally first appearing in the text of the Bible.
So the Bible. Star-crossed lovers appeared in the Bible. Little Adam and Eve, a little absolutely not. You disagree, all right, you would be correct. Oh, gets the square, excellent. The answer actually was William Shakespeare, all right? America's, or Britain's first sitcom and love story writer, all right. Making America great. You should be American. You should be American. All right, Shelby, just for fun. What's that?
Didn't you go to the theater school, you naughty boy?
I did, and I got a D in your class, so that's why I said that. All right, so Shelby, for the final tile, why don't we just say hello to Glenn Carman. Glenn, how you doing? All right, Glenn, here's your question as a Spanish teacher. All right, this is a tough one. Here we go. Glenn, ¿dónde está la biblioteca? ¿Dónde está la biblioteca?
What?
¿Dónde está la biblioteca?
La biblioteca
sí.
Está al norte de nosotros
sí.
En el campus.
Oh, sí, sí, sí. Magnífico, es muy, muy bueno, muy bueno, sí. ¿Qué país aquí del profesor Peter Steeves? ¿Qué país aquí del profesor Peter Steeves? A mí parece que Peter Steeves es un idiota, magnífico. Sí. All right. So, would you agree, Shelby, or disagree? It's a true cross question.
¿Yo me repite?
Yes,
okay, la biblioteca está al norte de nosotros en el campus.
Okay, so north of us. I'm just gonna agree.
All right, you agree. You are gonna get the square. X gets the square. Fantastic. All right, let's see that board.
That was our first winner.
She's our Shelby. Is our first winner. Fantastic.
Perfect to make with a hot plate in your dorm room. Please note, hot plates are illegal in dorm rooms. It's a box of Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco for our winner. It's a gift card to Barnes & Noble's bookstore for $100. That's insane. You can make at least one down payment on one textbook this quarter. Give a round of applause for our contestants. How about that? I think it's time for our first random celebrity professor spotlight.
That sounds like a great thing.
Let's see who it's going to be.
Let's see
who's
going to be.
Who's going to come up? Who's going to come up? Who are you going to talk to?
I don't know.
Which celebrity professor also
is going to be tonight? All right, here we go.
Oh! Look at that. It is Professor Ripley. Maybe you can talk to him a little bit. He had a book published about materialism recently. So maybe you can talk to him about that and find out how much money he's made from it since he's a materialist.
Sure. So Rick, all of us are familiar with Madonna's Material Girl. Would you say that you are the material boy?
I disagree.
Okay. All right, you play by your own rules. I like it. Rick, just tell us a little bit about your book and what gets you interested, huh?
I started out my book because I was at my Aunt Betty's funeral, my father's sister. And my Aunt Peggy, her sister-in-law, kept taking me around and introducing me to my relatives who I hadn't seen in a long time. And she kept saying, this is my godson, Rick. He's a professor of philosophy. And so she was really proud of me being not just a professor, which you could understand, but a professor of philosophy. She never went to college, so she has no idea what I do. And I tried to think through what is it that makes her so proud of something that she doesn't even really know. And so I started working through the idea that the generations of the past have a kind of pull on us for which we're responsible. This is what the philosopher Walter Benjamin, for those of you from America, what he calls a weak messianic power. And I tried to think this through then, the history of philosophy, not Socrates, but Aristotle, some other really famous people like Duns Scotus, that I'm sure you're all familiar with, Thomas Hobbes, and others.
Ooh, fantastic. Now, Rick, if we wanted to go buy that book right now, where would we go buy it?
Amazon.com.
Ooh, Amazon.com. Never heard of it. Interesting. All right.
It's on the interwebs. It's called The Thought of Matter.
Ah, excellent. Don't have a computer.
Richard A. Lee Jr. Gotcha. It makes a wonderful Hanukkah gift, Christmas gift, wedding anniversary gift, Mother's Day gift, Father's Day gift, 4th of July gift, Christmas gift.
And Aunt's funeral.
And Aunt Betty's funeral.
And Aunt Betty's funeral.
Thanks for killing my aunt. Yeah.
Well, Betty, wherever you are, thank you for giving the inspiration for a book. Excellent. And who says there's no life after death? All right.
You ready for another game?
I think we're ready for another round. What do you say, folks?
Woo! All right. Charlotte Blaze. Come on, yes. And Jasmina Semovic, you are the O in game number two.
All right, Charlotte, Jasmina, thank you so much for coming out. Really appreciate having you. All right, Charlotte, let's get to know you a little bit. What's your major here at DePaul University?
Sociology.
All right, great. Anything of peak interest that you've taken in sociology? Greg Scott's class. All right. Two for two for Greg Scott. Excellent. All right. Fantastic. Jasmina, how about you? Welcome to the stage. What is your major here at DePaul University?
I'm currently in the Master's of English, and I'm working on an ESL endorsement.
All right.
And I'm actually in Professor Bartlett's class.
Fantastic. An English graduate student. You am smart. Excellent. All right. Okay. So as always, X starts off the game. So Charlotte, why don't you take a have some fun with the board. What's that? Okay, who chose this?
Rick Lee.
You're gonna go with Rick Lee, right in the center. All right, Rick, excellent. Hello, Rick. All right. Man who's distracted at his own aunt's funeral. All right. René Descartes argued that the mind is separate from the body, thus leading to a dualism that continues to influence our culture. When questioned where the immaterial mind lives in the body, though, Descartes had an answer. In what part of the body, according to Descartes, is your mind located?
I think the way you would translate it into English most literally is the organ of desire. But before that, I would just like to disagree with the premise of the question, because I know that what the question is going for is the pituitary gland, which is an imagination of the diencephalon. It's about the size of a grape. But Descartes never argued that the mind is separate from the body. He argued no such thing. But given that some people, Peter Steeves, misunderstand Descartes, they might deem you to believe this, Peter Steeves. But the answer is the pituitary gland.
The pituitary gland. Excellent. All right, Charlotte, what do you think? You going to agree or disagree?
I might disagree.
You're going to disagree. You would be correct. Woo! It's the pineal gland. All right. The pineal gland. You might need to pay attention in your own philosophy classes. All right. All right, Jasmina, you have the board. Which tile would you like?
Professor Ostrowski.
Professor Ostrowski. Yeah, I don't know. You sure did. All right, Professor Ostrowski. In 1988, artist Christopher Wool created a painting, actually an alkyd set of letters on a rectangle of aluminum said to be currently worth $20 million that consisted of the words, sell the house, sell the car, sell the kids. The title of the painting is the same as the title of the movie Wool was quoting. What is the painting's title?
The painting's title, and you might have seen his exhibition at the Art Institute last summer, and if I remember correctly, that piece is called Jerry, Tell Me Something Sweet.
Sounds like they had a tepid relationship. All right, so Jerry, Tell Me Something Sweet is his answer. Would you agree or disagree? Taking a test right now, aren't you? Excellent. All right, you're gonna disagree. You would be correct. Oh, gets the square. The correct answer is Apocalypse Now. Apocalypse Now. All right, excellent. All right, Charlotte, you're on up. What tile would you like here? And speak into the microphone. It costs a lot of money. We need to use it.
Get your jack. Cost more.
You'd be wrong.
Let's go with Jesus Pendo.
Jesus Pando, excellent. All right, Jesus, excellent. Okay, Jesus, here's your question. From the moment of the Big Bang on, the universe has been expanding. But early on, and for a very brief time, roughly from the time the universe was 10 to 36 seconds old until it was 10 to 32 seconds old, the universe expanded incredibly fast. What is this belief, yet super fast expansion, usually called?
I do have a degree in this, I just want people to know that.
Excellent.
Inflation.
Inflation, all right, excellent. You're gonna say inflation. Charlotte, you gonna agree or disagree?
I don't know, I wanna disagree, but I feel like it's a more complicated answer, and he gave a simple one.
Well, then you would choose disagree.
Disagree,
you're gonna disagree with that? Ooh, I'm so sorry, that is actually correct. Oh, gets the square. Jesus, would you mind just expanding a little bit on that, about inflation? And I don't mean the one that hits my bank account, am I right, folks? Oh boy, I'm having fun.
So yeah, early on, the universe expanded very, very quickly. It's the reason why when I look up in the sky and I look at the world's, the universe's oldest light, it's all at the same temperature. It's all, because it was all at one time causally connected, we say. So the only one way that one can explain that is that the universe expanded very rapidly, very quickly, faster than the speed of light, actually. And we're actually now just expanding into regions that were disconnected at that time. So. I made all that up.
Amazing. All right, excellent. Thank you so much, Dr. Pendo. Jasmina, you are up.
Professor Susan,
excellent. Going with the professor first name. All right. Excellent, all right.
We're old friends.
Oh, excellent. Oh, my apologies.
We arranged this in advance.
Okay.
I want some of that rice-a-roni.
Okay.
Hopefully you lose, which is the first time I've told anybody that. All right, Professor Susan. Former U.S. Poet Laureate Donald Hall writes, as they killed her bone marrow again, she lay on a gurney, alone in a leaden room between machines that resembled pot-bellied stoves which spewed out total body irradiation. For 11 half-hour sessions measured over 4 days, it was as if she capped the Chernobyl pile with her body. About whom is he speaking?
Well, on that cheery note, one of my most favorite comic poets, Donald Hull, is talking about his wife, Jane.
His wife, Jane, excellent. Jasmina, what do you think? You gonna agree or disagree with that statement?
Agree.
If you're gonna agree, you are gonna be correct. Oh, gets the square. So, we have a win too, excellent. All right, Jasmina wins too, and I'm sorry there will be no rice or roni for you.
There are, but for Charlotte, our runner-up, it's a healthy part of a carb
heavy diet. It's a box of rice-a-roni in the San Francisco Free. And Jasmina, it's a gift card to Barnes & Nobles for an amount that is guaranteed to be somewhere between $100,000 and $100,000.
It's not transferable. All right, we're having fun, we're reading books, we're eating rice, excellent. All right, Peter, let's meet some of our panel.
Another Professor Spotlight, who will it be? We'll turn on the random calculator. It could be one, it could be another. But our spotlight falls on Pete. Maybe you can talk a little bit more to Professor Pondo. Specifically, I heard him saying something about how a Large Hadron Collider's recent discovery of the Higgs boson gives your mom so much mass that when she sits around the cosmos, she sits around the cosmos. Maybe you can talk to him about what a Higgs boson is and why he disses your mom.
Maybe you can explain that to my mom, who's sitting in the front audience. All right, Dr. Pando, the Hadron Collider, would you mind just briefly explaining to us exactly what that is and what it's used for and why it's so important?
Well, what it's used for is to crash proton and antiprotons together. And once you do that, you discover what the universe is made out of if you have enough energy to do that. They crash with enough energy. And one of the things that physicists have had a hard time trying to understand is where mass comes from. I thought it was pizza, but apparently it's not.
You and me both.
And it turns out that in the 60s, a group of mathematicians and mathematical physicists, one of which whose name was Higgs, devised a theory that said there must be this field called a Higgs field or particle, a Higgs particle, that actually gave stuff mass. That was predicted in the 60s. It was a sort of a sideline. As we got more and more knowledge and did more and more experiments, it was found that that particle effect had to exist if the current theories of elementary physics are correct. Europeans, countries from Asia, the United States built this god-awful expensive machine, about $10 billion, to find this one particle called the Higgs particle. And when they crashed protons with enough energy, sure enough, the Higgs particle showed up there and at least led us to believe that we're on the right track.
Ooh, excellent. Super exciting. Now that they found the Higgs particle that they've spent $10 billion on, does the Hadron Collider serve any purpose other than a tourist place and a gift shop?
It is the home of many future PhDs. It's used for employment for physicists. Computer scientists.
Excellent. On to the future. $10 billion for a job placement program. Excellent. Fantastic. All right.
Are you ready for another game, Pete?
Ready for another game.
Excellent.
Thank you so much. Let's bring down another contestant.
Our first X is Marisa Barnett. Come on down for game number seven, Marisa.
All right.
There she is.
Excellent. All right.
And O for game number three is Ryan Janning. Come on down, Ryan!
Yeah. Marisa, hello. Thank you so much for coming on up here. We really appreciate it. Marisa, I am sorry. I wasn't aware. I just met you. All right, Marisa, would you mind sharing with us, are you a DePaul student here? You are, all right. And how could it be? You seem too cool for school. All right, Marisa, what would be your major here while you're at DePaul?
I'm a psychology major.
Could you understand the psychology? I got it. The psychology of speaking into a microphone? No. All right. Super fun. Here we go. All right. Thank you, Marisa, for putting your name to come on up to the stage. Excellent. All right. Thank you. Brian, who has the disposition completely opposite of Marisa. Ryan, welcome. Thank you for coming on up. Ryan, are you a student here at DePaul?
I am.
All right, fantastic. And Ryan, what is your major?
I'm a double major in finance and philosophy.
A double major in finance and philosophy. Rick, which one do you think is going to make money? Yeah, okay, all right. Hey, all right, it's purely academic, I'm sure. Fantastic. All right, and Ryan, between the two, what are you leaning towards more, finance or philosophy?
Well, my goal is I want to think about making money and just do that.
So does everyone else in the world. All right, you're a good company. Fantastic. All right, Marissa, we're going to have you start this round, all right? Which square do you want?
I'll go with Rick Lee.
You're going to go with Rick Lee. All right, sounds good. All right, Rick, here you go. All right. In the film The Big Lebowski, Jeffrey Lebowski encounters a group of Germans who pretend to kidnap a woman and write a fake ransom note requesting $1 million and no funny stuff. What school of philosophy does the group claim to follow?
So in The Big Lebowski, the dude is the main character, and he has two friends who are on his bowling team, Donnie and Walter. And Donnie is actually an interesting character who kind of is confused an awful lot. Like, he confuses John Lennon with Lenin, the former leader of the Soviet Union.
They look alike.
Shut up, Donnie.
Shut up, Donnie. Yeah. They look very similar. Yeah. They both had number one hits, too.
Cuckoo, ka-choo. At a point in the movie, Donnie refers to them as Nazis, to which Walter responds, "Donnie, they weren't Nazis, they were nihilists. Say what you want about the tenets of National Socialism, at least those people had an ethos." The answer is nihilists.
Nihilists, all right. Marissa, are you going to agree or disagree?
I'll agree.
You're going to agree? Excellent. You would be correct. X gets the square. Fantastic. All right. Ryan, you're on up. What tile would you like?
I'll take Greg Scott.
You'll take Greg Scott. All right, everybody's second choice.
We are redheads.
Fantastic. All right, Greg, here you go. You have famously immersed yourself in Chicago's drug culture as a researcher and documentarian, helping prevent the spread of HIV, AIDS, and other diseases among injection drug users and their partners. Can you tell us what sort of drug is naloxone? No.
That's spell that out. Let's spell that out.
Naloxone. I took some beforehand. Naloxone.
Naloxone.
There we go.
Is the name of the drug that you're referring to. It's a generic injectable that's been around since the late 1970s, early 1980s. And naloxone went by a brand name initially because it was patented, and it was called Narcan. So there are movies that reference this. Famously, perhaps, there's Bringing Out the Dead. Anyone's seen that? It's a good film. And then we have another film where there is an overdose reversal that's become quite famous cinematically. That film is, anybody know it? Uma Thurman?
Under the Tuscan Sun.
Right. So what they're doing in this film is they're trying to revive Uma Thurman's character after she had overdosed on heroin, which she thought was cocaine, but she was wrong. And heroin is an opioid, mm-hmm. and it shuts down the brain's capacity to remind the lungs to keep working.
It's kind of a key thing.
It is. So naloxone is a bit of a miracle drug in that it actually wakes that part of the brain up and allows that part of the brain to say to the lungs, get back to work, and thus reverses respiratory cessation. So it starts up the respiratory system again, and naloxone, this generic injectable, is the miracle drug that brings people back to life after they've succumbed to an opioid overdose, whether it's heroin or Vicodin or Dilaudid or OxyContin.
Or Hershey's.
Or Hershey's. Kiss.
All right, Ryan, naloxone. Are you going to agree or disagree?
I'll agree.
You're going to agree? You would be correct. Oh, gets the square. Thank you so much. Thank God I don't have to say that word again. All right, Marissa, you're up. Go with Lisa, all right, on a first-name basis, all right. All right, Dr. Portes, here is your question, all right. Graffiti is a controversial art form. One of your own stage productions even came under criticism for being inappropriate for young adults because it might make graffiti look acceptable as an art. But some graffiti has garnered mainstream art's praise. What mysterious artist recently created a gallery theme park in the United Kingdom entitled Dismal Land?
Well, you know, what would be debatable is whether this particular artist is actually a graffiti artist, because those who are in the graffiti world would say that it's not graffiti unless it's illegal. So you have to kind of parse between work that is permission walls, work that is street art, and work that is graffiti, which by definition, at least in the United States, by graffiti artists in the United States, is illegal. However, this artist is British, and
you sure he's not American?
British.
Like Shakespeare? All right.
Goes by the name of Banksy.
Banksy, all right. Banksy is the answer. Do you agree or disagree?
I'll agree.
You'll agree, she'll agree. You would be correct. X gets the square. Excellent. Go for the block here and any direction here. What, who are you going to go for?
Well, I don't speak Spanish, but I'll go with Glenn.
All right, Glenn Carmen. All right. Glenn, beginning Spanish students often have difficulty with the verb ser and estar because there is only one verb in English that translates these two different verbs in Spanish. What is the appropriate English translation for both ser and estar?
Can I have another question about the biblioteca?
In case section is a libro de Anna Green Gables. Okay, gracias.
So, say and estar, both translate as to have.
Okay.
In English.
To have in English.
Sounds right, I'll agree.
Well, you would be wrong, Ryan. I'm sorry. Since you did get that wrong, that square does not go to X because it does not get to a default win for her. So, Marissa, you have your options. You can either ask Glenn a question again, or Warren, or, okay. You just can't win with Glenn unless you do it yourself.
I'll ask Glenn a question, or you can ask Glenn a question.
Oh, thank you. Will you let me? But can I? Thank you. All right. Okay, here we go. Glenn, up again. Don Quixote is often said to be the first modern novel, yet a work by Apuleius written in ancient Roman Latin predates Cervantes' novel by almost 1,500 years and has several novel-like qualities. What is the title of Apuleius' work? Is it A, The Golden Dawn, B, The Golden Path, C, The Golden Way, or D, The Golden Ass?
So I'm the only one who gets a multiple choice question?
They're peppered in there.
Okay, did you tell him what ser and estar mean?
My Spanish is rusty, but no.
To be.
Yeah, ser is the verb to be. From the Hamlet question to ser or no to ser. Es la pregunta importante.
Okay, so the Apuleius work, sometimes called a Roman novel, it's a long work of fiction and it has many, many characteristics of what we'd call a novel. So it's, you know, it depends on how you define a novel, but this is an important work for people like Cervantes, and it had a couple names. Originally it was called Metamorphoses, none of the four options that you've given me. But later on it was given another name, Augustine, we got from St. Augustine, the name of the Golden Ass.
All right, the Golden Ass, all right. Are you going to agree or are you going to disagree? Sounded convincing. I'll agree. All right. Well, you would be correct. It is the Golden Ass. And another winner. And Peter, what do they win?
As always, for our runner-up, it's a box of Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco team. Yes, Rice-A-Roni. It's like Pete Asbury just exploded a little bit in your mouth. And for our winner, a shopping spree at Barnes & Noble's bookstore that you'll probably just use online anyway because your generation does everything online. Seriously, what's wrong with you? It's a $100 Barnes & Noble gift card!
Quite the prize for some of you who didn't want to be here. All right, fantastic. Peter, let's meet another one of our
fans. It's time to turn that random generator on one more time and see who's going to pop up on the screen. It's usually the third that comes up, I think, isn't it? And it is. So this is Professor Ann Bartlett. Pete, she's not only in the English department, but she's been working on promoting collaboration across DePaul, and she recently, like seriously 2 days ago, took a brand new position. So you may want to talk to her a little bit about this.
Excellent. Now, Ann, you will be leaving us, as Peter just mentioned, to the state of Washington, Tacoma. What is the one thing that you're going to miss about the DePaul campus life?
Oh, wow, that's a really tough question. Oh, you know, I've been here my whole career. So I've been here since 1993, which, you know, nobody do any math and figure out how old, you know, all of us are. But, yeah,
wow. You're going to miss demon dogs?
Well, I miss the French, the cheese fries. For sure, yeah, the cheese fries. I miss the people. All of the people, they're just such
good. I'm going to disagree on that one. what will be your new position, too, now that you're going to?
Well, it's kind of a mouthful. So I will be dean of the School of Interdisciplinary Arts and Sciences.
Now, in your opinion, what from your career would enabled you to land this superior position?
I have no idea.
No idea, not even a little. Excellent. Well, what from your experiences in academia too? What is what is the work that makes you the most proud?
I would have to say my scholarly work as a medievalist is really important. I came along in the 80s and 90s, you know, way back in the last century, when people were just starting to think about women in the Middle Ages. And before that, everybody just thought about men and battles and kings. They didn't even think about queens. And so nobody ever really thought about, okay, so who's manning the manor when the guys are off at court or in crusades or at war and they never come back? The women were collecting taxes, convening juries, writing, ordering translations, training people to make war, and even defending their castles.
Fantastic! Wow, yeah. Excellent. So I can kind of see the similarity too. You know, the war effort too during World War II, even you know the effort that kind of compares to. Yeah. Yeah, excellent. You see, folks, even though I left college, I can still bullshit my way through paper.
All right, time for another game?
I think we have time for one more.
It's time for excellent. Game number four. We only have two left. So our X for game four is Victoria Simic. Come on down! You are the X for game number four, Victoria. And our O for game four, Adriana.
Victoria, Adrian, thank you so much for coming on down. Victoria, would you mind telling us a little bit about yourself?
Sure, I'm a double demon, and I work here at the university in the STEM Center.
Ooh, excellent. Now, some of us are stupid, so we don't know what STEM means.
STEM stands for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math.
Excellent. Four things I'm not qualified to be a part of. Excellent. Now, you say you're a double demon. Would you mind explaining that?
Sure. I got my undergrad degree in communication and my graduate degree in writing here at the university.
Fantastic. Awesome. Very cool. Adriana. I'm sorry. I'm a little deaf in this right ear from the train accident. We don't need to talk about it. It's okay. I still see it every day.
I'm a psychic driver.
No one can help me.
We can talk.
Okay,
okay.
Thank
we can
you.
Talk afterwards.
Excellent. You just share what your major is. I appreciate it.
I paid for the double major itself, so great stuff. Even though I can't see this class, it's
expensive. Oh no, I'm sorry. A major in psychology and sociology. What would you say has been the most interesting thing you've learned here? Oh, I'm sorry.
No one else can ask that question.
Well, because I only give it to the smart people.
I'm smart. So that's the answer. I'm smart, so I'm
going to... The answer to the most interesting thing you've learned here is that you're smart. Yeah. Excellent. All right, thank you so much, Adriana. All right. X starts off the game first.
Pete, why does X always get to start?
Because it comes first in the alphabet.
Sorry, just wanted to clear that up.
Excellent. All right. Three, you have the board here. Why don't you go take it away?
Have to start with Rick Lee.
Rick Lee, again. So he's in everyone's first choice. All right, Rick Lee. All right, here we go. British philosopher Thomas Hobbes wrote that human life has five essential qualities. According to Hobbes, life is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and blank.
I agree.
Do you agree or disagree on that one, Tori?
Could you repeat the question again?
I sure can. British philosopher Thomas Hobbes wrote that human life has five essential qualities. According to Hobbes, life is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and...
So Hobbes was the originator of this tradition that sometimes is called social contract theory, which tries to figure out the origin of society by asking, what would we do in order to enter into the society? Would you enter into the society given a choice, and what would those conditions look like? And there are other social contract theorists like Locke, Rousseau, to a certain extent Kant, and most of them they try to imagine humans in a state of nature, they call it. For Hobbes, this was a state of war of all against all, in which everyone has a right to everyone's possessions and their life. And in such a condition, Hobbes says that life is solitary, nasty, brutish, and short.
Short is the answer. Agree or disagree? Are you taking... Wait, hold on. Are you taking signs from the audience?
I don't know.
These are my groupies. They follow me to every game show I participate in.
So this is their first one. All right. Short is the answer. Are you going to agree or disagree? Disagree. You would be wrong. It is short. Adriana gets the square. Excellent. All right. Still plenty of time left. Adriana, which title would you like? And if you say Greg Scott, I'm going to lose it.
Greg Scott.
Okay. All right.
Why did you take my class?
Part of. God, glad we got to see it. Anywho, we've got a game show going on here. All right, Greg Scott, your question. Sawbuck Productions Incorporated is an award-winning film company that creates and distributes media geared toward documenting the people, places, and things that operate on the fringes. It has branched out from independent shorts to public radio documentaries to work with the National Geographic Channel on cable television. In street parlance, what is a sawbuck? What is a sawbuck?
In the 1800s, people referred to the $10 bill as a sawbuck. Now, people use the word sawbuck to refer to somebody who is attractive on a 10-point scale, and they're at a 10. So say, wow, he's a sawbuck, meaning he's really attractive.
All right, so 1800s, that person was a sawbuck. Man, that person sure is a sawbuck. Would you mind using it in a sentence, Greg?
Man, he's a sawbuck.
There we go, Excellent. Are you going to agree or disagree?
I'm sorry, Greg, but I don't agree.
She disagrees, she is correct. She is correct in that, because the answer actually is a $10 bill, or we would have also accepted a $10 bag of drugs. Excellent, excellent. All right. Toria, you have the board now. Would you mind picking the one? I would go with one versus...
Jesus.
Jesus, excellent. All right, Jesus, 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 excellent. All right, your question. Not all of the universe is visible to us. According to the standard model of cosmology, within 5 percentage points, what percentage of the total mass energy content of the universe is likely a combination of dark matter and dark energy? Dark matter, dark energy.
Could you repeat that?
I sure can. I can repeat the whole thing. Not all of the universe is visible to us. According to the standard model of cosmology, within 5 percentage points, what percentage of the total mass energy content of the universe is likely a combination of dark matter and dark energy?
95
right on the way low.
I agree.
You're going to agree. All right, excellent. X gets the square. 95 on the top. All right. We got a lot of attention. We're going to get all the questions. All right. Brianna, you're up next. You'll take Warren. Excellent. It sounds like you're calling a kickball team. All right. I'll take Warren. All right. Warren, get ready.
Can I change?
I don't know why you would. All right. Warren.
Yes.
In one of the earliest tales in the Arabian Nights, a husband employs a parrot to spy on his wife. After learning of the treacherous parrot, the wife tells a slave to turn a handmill under the bird's cage. She tells another slave to throw water on top of the cage. And she tells a third slave to take a mirror and turn it in front of the parrot's eyes by the light of a candle all night long. What is it that the parrot tells the husband the next day?
A job interview?
A job interview. The parrot says a job interview.
No, actually, what it is, he's, the wife is attempting to trick the parrot by convincing it that it lived through a rainstorm. Because in this particular story, it's taking place in the summer. And if the parrot tells the husband that he just survived a nightly rainstorm, the husband will not believe the parrot, and therefore the husband will not believe what the parrot told him the previous night, which is that his wife was unfaithful to him.
Ah, excellent. All right. So the parrot said that it got in a rainstorm. All right. Do you agree? You're going to agree with that. Excellent. You would be correct. Oh, guess the square. Not wise to trust what an animal says. I've gotten in a lot of trouble for trusting what a parrot said. Okay.
There's a story about that.
Ah, can't wait to read it. All right, Victoria, you are on up. What tile square would you like?
I will pick Susan.
You will pick Susan. Excellent, excellent, excellent. All right, Susan. After news of this playwright's death reached Athens 2,422 years ago, Sophocles honored his rival at the next dramatic competition by dressing his chorus in black robes rather than white robes. What is the name of the frenemy that Sophocles was honoring?
You're going to have to repeat that one.
Okay, all right, running out of oxygen. After news of this playwright's death reached Athens 2,422 years ago, Sophocles honored his rival at the next dramatic competition by dressing his chorus in black robes rather than white robes. What is the name of the frenemy that Sophocles was honoring?
Well, it must have been because they were frenemies indeed, so it must have been the other rival playwright, Euripides.
Euripides. Euripides is the answer. Do you agree or disagree?
I'm going to agree.
Excellent. You would be correct. X gets the square. It is Euripides. Fantastic. All right. Brianna, you're up. What square would you like? What's that?
Anne.
You would like Mr. Anne Bartlett. Fantastic. Anne, here we go. Are you ready? All right, and the following quote, which might relate to tonight's celebrity professor guests, especially Rick Lee there in the center square, comes from which play by American playwright William Shakespeare? Hell is empty and all the devils are here. Hell is empty and all the devils are here.
What was the question?
Ocean over here. The following quote, which might relate to tonight's celebrity professor guests, especially Rick Lee there in the center square, comes from which play by American playwright William Shakespeare. Hell is empty and all the devils are here. What play is from this, is the quote from of Hell is empty and all the devils are here?
That does relate to tonight, doesn't it?
It does.
I would say it's gotta be Dante.
Dante.
American playwright.
Yes, American playwright.
Dante was from 13th century Florence. He wrote poetry in terza rima, so that totally means it was him.
Okay, it's Dante. So Dante is your answer. Are you going to agree or disagree? You're going to agree. It would be incorrect because it's not. It's the answer is The Tempest. The Tempest, right? X gets the square on that. Fantastic. All right, so we have quite a game coming up here. All right, Victoria, what square would you like here?
Zach, please.
Zach. Zach Ostrowski. Excellent. Zach. Your question is here. Yoga is a physical, mental, and spiritual practice or discipline that originated in India. The familiar Hatha yoga, for instance, is all about assuming different physical postures in order to promote health. On what does the practice of Hatha yoga focus?
This is my question.
This is your question. This is your question.
Of course it's my question because I'm a master yoga expert. So, it actually, believe it or not, it's a fact that the best episode of Miami Vice is one with James Brown when he played a cult leader, and he was actually an expert of the Hiawanasatha form. So, that's the answer. He featured in that episode.
Okay. So your answer is Hiawanasatha. Hiawanasatha is your answer.
Yes.
Is your answer. Do you agree or disagree?
I'm going to disagree.
You can disagree. That is a good move, because that's incorrect. The correct answer is laughter. Hatha yoga is the practice of prolonged mindful laughter. And someone who's not laughing, it's our runner-up.
There we go. Excellent.
You'll come for the rice, you'll stay for the roni, and eventually leave for the bathroom. It's a box of rice, a roni for Adriana. And for our winner, Victoria, you know that overpriced sweatshirt you want that says DePaul on it that was probably handmade by children in Thailand factory longing for the sweet release of debt? It's a Barnes & Noble's gift card for $100. Well, folks, we have time for one more random celebrity professor spotlight. Who's our next interview?
Well, it's going to be determined here by the computer. This is the last one of the evening. It's going to be... Professor Ostrowski and Professor Scott. You know, they work as a team often, so it's interesting they came up together. Maybe you can talk to them about a little bit about their work together.
Fantastic. Yeah, so Zach and Greg, Peter tells me that you have made some interesting films. Would you mind telling us about a current project that you're working on? Or?
Magic. Yeah, we'll talk about the magic. We're making a film. We're capturing magic onto a camera, and you can't see it with your eyes.
I didn't realize I was being filmed.
Yeah. I'm filming your reaction.
What was that?
I'm filming your reaction. That was my magic. Right now.
Excellent. Excellent. I'm sad, so you might have to work it out.
There's a town in western Michigan called Colon, and it's the magic capital of the world. And they have a small cemetery called Lakeside Cemetery. That's where all of the famous magicians are buried. And every year they have an annual magic festival. And I performed there in 2012. I did an ode to Ricky Dunn and Mookie Blaylock at the gravesite of Ricky Dunn, the world's greatest pickpocket. And Greg and I have been doing research. We're working with a magician and a bodybuilder in Colon, Michigan, to make a fake real movie that will be a triple projection installation about magic.
Fantastic. Sounds fascinating. I mean, you said this town of Michigan was Colon, Michigan?
Colon, Michigan.
Colon, Michigan. Sounds like a lovely place. Fantastic. Now, Zach, what kind of magic tricks can you do?
Greg, do you want to answer that?
What kind of magic tricks can Zach do?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
He can make confetti disappear from the palm of his hand. So he can make a fist and then it just goes away. And it's It's amazing. I mean, you just have to see that?
I did not see it. That's amazing. That's amazing. Did not even see any confetti.
But we caught it on film. Because that's what we do. We make films that can't actually be shot on film. And they can't actually be viewed. It's a very specific kind of filmmaking. And we're very good at it. Right? Yeah, we're very good at it.
Excellent. Sounds like a blockbuster. All right. Now, all right, so we have time for one more game. Thank you so much for that. Give him a round of applause. I want to see that game. We have time for one more round here. You guys have been absolutely fantastic. We have time for one more round. Peter,
you ready?
Come on up.
The last name to come out. Sherwin. Come on down.
Sherwin. Sherwin. Come on down. Come on down, Sherwin.
The final O is Caitlin Billow. Come on down.
Sherwin, Caitlin. Sherwin and Caitlin. Here we go. Galen, welcome. Welcome, welcome. Don't worry about it. All right. Sherwin, Galen, welcome to the stage here. Sherwin, would you mind giving us a little bit about yourself? What's your major, if you are a DePaul student?
Yeah, I'm a philosophy major.
You're a philosophy major. Excellent. Now, as all philosophers can do, can you expand on that thought?
Not really. philosophy is the field of being ridiculous.
All right. Now, would you mind describing yourself?
Pretty square and ridiculous.
You picked the right game, then, didn't you, Sherwin? All right. Excellent. Caitlin. Hi. Welcome to the stage. Thank you for coming on up. Caitlin, are you a DePaul student?
I am.
Fantastic. And what is your major?
I am a communications and media major.
Communications and media major. Fantastic. What have you? What's the best way to communicate on social media?
best platform. What's your target audience?
My target audience? Anybody who will listen to me.
I think you have a very good chance.
So you're saying the internet is not for me?
Twitter.
We'll go with the safe Twitter. Okay, fantastic. Do you have a Twitter handle or anything like that?
Yeah, but I never use it, so I'm not even sure what it is.
I'm going to disagree with that one.
Maybe Caitlin Biro?
You sure?
Caitlin and Biro?
Okay.
Check it out.
All right. Well, make sure you have it ready for your final. But all right. Let's play the final round of DePaulywood Squares here. All right. So as always, X starts it off. Sherwin, would you mind picking the square to start us on off?
Yeah, I'm going to have to go with my man, Rick Lee.
My man, Rick Lee. Cool. Excellent. All right. Rick Lee. Can't wait to hear from you. All right. Rick, French existentialist philosopher John Paul Sartre is famous for claiming that hell is blank. Hell is blank.
Playing this game with Peter Steeves.
What? Hell is blank.
Really, Peter, you've only asked me questions about two real philosophers. Then we have freaking Socrates and now John Paul Sartre.
Small side note, in class, he told us that was one of his least favorite philosophers.
I think we get it. I think we get it.
So, Jean-Paul Sartre was a friend, as the question asked, a French existentialist who is important for any angsty teenager and not much beyond that. He also happened to be a Nobel Prize, I was about to say winning, but author, and he wrote several plays and novels and so on. And one of the plays he wrote is called No Exit, and it's a play about a group of people sitting in a room talking with one another for a long, long time. And at first everything's going fine, and then as these things happen, like everyone gets annoying after a while. And it turns out that these people start getting on one another's nerves, and they realize that hell is other people.
Hell is other people. Excellent. Sherwin, you going to agree or disagree?
I'm going to agree.
You're going to agree? You are going to be correct. X gets the square. Excellent. Yes. That is other people who would have also accepted the CTA red line. All right, Caitlin, you're on up. Which square would you like?
Let's go with Professor Susan.
Professor Susan. All right, excellent. Professor Susan.
Here we go.
All right, Professor Susan. In Greek mythology, Medea helped her husband steal a golden fleece, and then, when eventually betrayed by him, she murdered their children. What is the name of Medea's husband?
Well, let me see now. Let's see. She had a lot of reason to murder him, just as a sidebar. He was...
It's good to have a motive when you murder somebody.
But she murdered the children instead, of course, to get back into even Warren. By the way, she also managed to... one of the reasons she was angry with him was that he was marrying the princess, the king's daughter, and so she gave them a wedding present of a gown that was poisoned. So that was an interesting method. But the guy who did her wrong is named Jason.
Jason. Jason, you gonna agree or disagree? Jason. You're going to disagree. I'm so sorry. You're going to be wrong. It is Jason. Jason was the husband who betrayed her. Sherwin gets the square here. Nothing like a classic Greek name. Euripides, Socrates, and Jason. Great Greek philosopher, Jason. Okay, all right. So, we're at an interesting point here, Sherwin. You can either go for the final square here and win the game, or we can get to learn some more stuff. So it's up to you. Do you want to learn more, or do you want to win the game? It's up to you. Either answer is acceptable. Do you want to learn more, or do you want to get greedy and win money?
Well, because I've got to finish a paper for Wrigley, I'm going to have to be greedy and go for the game.
Again, I'm going to disagree with that, but all right. All right, so you said Warren? Dr. Warren Schultz? All right, excellent. Dr. Warren Schultz, all right. Okay, here we go. For potentially the final question and the end of the night, ruining it for everybody. The fourth, for a $100 gift card, you'll throw everybody under the bus, all right. The Fourth Crusade, which took place in the early 13th century, culminated with the Crusaders' brutal sacking of what important city?
Fourth Crusade is a terribly controversial episode of medieval history. It involved no women, so Anne doesn't know anything about it.
Sick academic burn.
As they marched their way across Europe, Fourth Crusaders fell into debt. And in order to pay off their debt, they took a loan from the dreaded Venetians. And the Venetians were desperate to control more ports in the surrounding seas, and so they diverted the Crusaders to the Hungarian Christian town of Zara.
Zara. Zara was the town that was sacked. Zara, Sherwin, do you agree or disagree?
Well, actually, Zara is my mother's name, so that's interesting.
Totally.
But I feel like he's pulling a fast one. I'm going to say disagree.
You're going to say disagree? You would be correct in here. It was Constantinople. Next gets the square. Sherwin wins the game and ends the night. Here's all of our winners that won.
You got it, Pete. For our runner-up win in San Francisco, ask any woman or man working a street corner for a treat. You're sure to get a box of this. It's Rice Cerrone, the San Francisco treat. And for our winner, Sherwin, something really special. Sherwin, pick one of the following. A $100 Barnes & Noble's gift card, or a new car?
The new car, obviously.
You have eliminated the new car. It is the $100 Barnes & Noble's gift card. A big round of applause for Sherwin.
Fantastic. All right, thank you. Thanks for everybody who came up and played tonight. Peter, you want to close us out? Or
yeah, thank you very much, everybody, for coming out on our first experimental hub to Hollywood Squares. A big round of applause for the one and only sparkly Pete Parsons. And a humongous round of applause. Keep it going for all of our